Great. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Chloe Schaefer with the Cape Cod Commission. Thank you for joining us. This is our accommodations-focused Cape Cod Business Resilience Workshop, and this is the first of a two-part series. I'm just going to provide a little brief introduction here before handing it over to our consultants to really dig into the meat of today's discussion. So if I could get the next slide, please. So very briefly, for those of you who aren't familiar with the Cape Cod Commission, we're the regional planning agency serving the 15 towns of Barnstable County. And our mission is really focused on coordinating a balanced relationship between environmental protection and economic progress for the region. Next slide. Since the pandemic, we have been working on collecting data in various forms to try to understand better the impact it's having on the region, as well as then trying to understand how we can support our region through this. Part of this effort has involved our Data Cape Cod website. Go to the next slide, please. This provides data across a host of various issue areas, such as unemployment and housing, in relation to the pandemic to help people get a better understanding of what's been going on throughout Cape Cod. These are all interactive online dashboards, so you can drill down into the data as you'd like. And one of the key areas that we do have data on for this is our business impact surveys. I'd like to go to the next. So we've issued three surveys in conjunction with the Cape Cod Chamber of Commerce throughout the course of the pandemic to understand more specifically the impacts our business owners have been feeling due to the pandemic. We just finished the third survey in January. And when we look at specifically the accommodations businesses here, 14% were due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Over half of the respondents said they don't expect a return to normal operations for 6 months or more. And as you can see in the top right corner here, severe losses when comparing revenue from 2020 to 2019. Additionally, about a third said they still needed communications, marketing, social media, and online sales support, and only 16% were leveraging that. And that will really make up a lot of the resources that we'll be talking about today. So hopefully that will help. You could go to the next slide. And just very briefly, these workshops are a part of a three-pronged approach to a broader business recovery and resiliency planning effort that the commission's undertaking. We do have these industry-specific workshops. The first one's occurring now this week, and then a second part will be happening in late April and early May. As part of this, we'll also be producing business toolkits to help businesses recover and be more resilient into the future, providing resources, what they can do to foster that. And all of this will help us in developing a regional economic resiliency plan. So I'm now going to hand it over to Michael Aparicio from RevB, who is going to dig into the meat of today's presentation.
Great. Well, thank you very much for the introduction. And we're very happy to be with you this afternoon. I'm the founder and principal consultant of RevB. We are a small business consulting company and technical assistance provider. And over the past year, spending a lot of time helping small business owners really manage through the COVID-19 pandemic. I'm also joined by one of my colleagues, Estefania Lopez. She is one of our consultants on the RevB team. And we're here, as mentioned, with an initiative with the Cape Cod Commission to create some resources to help Cape Cod small businesses not only recover, but also help businesses become more resilient. We have several poll questions scheduled throughout our presentation today. And one of the objectives of this first of a two series workshop is to gather some feedback, kind of learn what areas that you might need some help in terms of resilience planning and continuity. So your feedback is really helpful. We will also introduce some elements of business resilience and continuity. And then we will go into our main focus of the day, which is on digital marketing strategies, which is an area raised as a need, an ongoing need, through the surveys that had already been conducted across Cape Cod, but also we know is a very significant means of business continuity. Also, this presentation is being recorded, so don't worry about scrambling and taking notes. You will have access to your recording, but also a copy of the slides. As we go through, please feel free also to submit any questions in the Q&A chat. We will have some time for questions at the end. So don't hesitate to put in some questions and notes in there. So it's really hard to believe that we're coming up now about a year since the first COVID-19 restrictions went into effect. We've seen some amazing examples of resilience across the country, but also across Cape Cod. We kind of wonder what are the factors that support resilience? And this quote, published in the midst of the shutdowns last year by Harvard Business Review, I feel puts it really succinctly, those elements. A resilient business is one with the capacity to absorb stress, recover critical functionality, and thrive in altered circumstances. So you really kind of see three elements here in place. You know, first, in a crisis and sudden disruptions, there's a lot of stress involved. There's a lot going on. It's not only in your business, but also in personal life. So there's definitely a need for a personal capacity of resilience. And then second, the process of assessing and reorganizing your resources. And third, that a process of accepting change and being able to execute and do plan to continue operations. We had a lot of conversations with business owners in the beginning of the pandemic, and we heard a lot that they were just really relying on things going back to normal as quickly as possible. And sometimes that is just not going to happen. The world is changing for a number of reasons, even outside of a pandemic. So in some cases, adaptation is needed in a new environment. So we'll talk a little bit about these elements of resilience and continuity planning. So a plan can look rather different depending on the type of your business, the size, and how much detail you feel is needed for your business. But we feel it can be boiled down to at least these four components: financial, people, your physical assets, and your operations and systems. So on the financial side, it's having those relationships in place, getting access to emergency capital, having alternatives in place, the ability to restructure any commitments. Just what is the plan implementing a contingency plan on your financials? We actually started off our series with a workshop on pandemic-related funding and the PPP and other government programs. So if you missed that, please get in touch with the Cape Cod Commission for a link, or go to a website to find a recording of that. But I'll just mention something very briefly. Even since that workshop, just about a couple of weeks ago, some new developments have already been introduced with the PPP. Specifically, if you are a sole proprietor or single member LLC, the calculation formula has changed just in recent legislation. So if you're not aware of that, please take a moment to look that up, because that could be important for you if you've not yet obtained a PPP loan in the second draw. So just wanted to quickly mention that. Moving along to some of the other areas, having a plan around your people, kind of assessing your team's capacity to adapt through change, and having communications plans, whether that's internally amongst your team and externally with your customers and suppliers. Physical assets, so your property, this might include assessing risks across each component on your property, and kind of having a plan if you might have limited access to certain equipment. If you sell products as well, having a plan around protecting your inventory. And then operations and systems, this could mean, having diversified revenue streams, so you're not exposed too much on one revenue stream itself. A lot of this also is the digital aspect. Making sure that you have kind of systems to recover data if needed, or if you want to review your supply chain, that you might have alternatives in place if there is supply chain disruption. And we certainly saw that during the COVID-19 pandemic. With this sort of brief introduction of some of these components, we'll use our first poll to just kind of check in and hear from you. Where do you feel that you would need some more support in the elements of business resilience and continuity? So access to capital, business model realignment, that communications plan, IT, data aspects, leadership, digital strategy, including marketing, people, or the physical assets. So I'll go ahead and launch our first poll, and we'll welcome your feedback. And the information that you'll share here also helps us to prioritize the toolkits that we will be creating as well for the different industry sector groups. So we'll be creating one for accommodations and hospitality sector. So I'll leave the poll open for just a short while here and welcome your feedback. Just some of the early results that are coming in. We're seeing some responses around the information technology and data, also online and digital strategy components. And we'll give it just a couple more seconds for any additional feedback coming through on our first poll question. Great, so it looks like that those are the two components and some additional input as well across, in fact, now most of the areas, access to capital, communications, business model realignment. So thank you very much. I'll go ahead and close out that poll. And move on to our next area. So we also took a look at what were the trends across the accommodations and hospitality industry itself. And you know what we saw over the last year, you know, around a few different components here. So digital for sure. And this was sort of a trend even happening before the pandemic. Kind of this new industry of hotel SaaS, software as a service. There's more digital software and platforms becoming available for hotels. It's sort of this kind of ecosystem that is very familiar for those that might already know about e-commerce tools. This growing industry could be opening up new opportunities for hoteliers to kind of modernize their infrastructure and provide more value to their customers. There is this multi-channel approach as well, where it's not just in-person interaction or relying on one channel for online bookings, but really looking at multiple options to access potential visitors, people. So, you know, there's because of the restrictions in place and regulations through the pandemic, it just really put a spotlight on the need for training and making sure people were prepared to align with new operations. And that really translates to the customer experience as a whole. So a lot of attention on service training and customers. So opening up new customer segments in some cases. We saw that the value proposition for hotels and other accommodations businesses were changing. Where the value was really offering a staycation or for those on a road trip. The customer segment was probably a little bit different. Maybe there was more demand by maybe more local audience than you were used to before, probably a lot less international audience. But then just in general across the board, just a very focus on transparency. So with this experience, building in those values into your operations, because we think that's something that's going to really stick. In operations, you know, contactless check-in and having, again, you know, these different experiences where it's not just in person, but also really that hybrid of making use of technology as part of the service you're providing. So again, that changed value proposition. When it came to food, maybe not that direct interaction, kind of giving people different opportunities, still again, add that value and be able to prepare food for people, but just that really looked different once they were at your property. And then diversifying revenue streams, creative ways of monetizing your space differently. So just a few trends that we saw across the industry. And Estefania is going to share just a few examples of other businesses across New England that we think might be interesting for you as well. Estefania.
Yes, thank you, Michael. So we definitely will see some of those trends in execution within the next three examples. The first one we have for you is Red Lion. Red Lion is a family-owned luxury business, a hotel in the Berkshires, and they have been open since before the 1800s. They refreshed the new Red Lion experience and then included some new cleanliness standards and communicated very clearly the protocols that they will be following with social distancing, so the customers will feel at ease when arriving and they knew what to expect. They also have new and creative packages, such as the Celebrate with RLI through social media. And when you start your booking, you can decide to celebrate for any reason, perhaps a birthday or a graduation or something that to get you out of the routine. And if you choose this package, they have about 25% off. They have a work, stay, and rock package. With the pandemic and everybody working from home, everybody will desire to have a change of scenery. And so in this case, they allow you to have a certain discount depending on how many nights you book. And in this case, they have a specific working stations for you at the hotel, and that you can work with an amazing view. The reservation fee is an optional fee that you can opt to pay. If you decide to help the preservation of all the antiques within the hotel and preservation for the vitality of the actual business.
And then, Stephanie, I think that your audio is cutting out, and I think maybe others can hear that as well. So apologies for that, but maybe I'll kind of jump in while Estefania is working on her audio. But this example here, just again, kind of assessing, what is those value experiences that people were looking for, and implementing that for their guests. I'll move on to the next example. So a boutique hotel in Providence, Rhode Island, and again, kind of assessing their changed customer landscape. They were not catering to their typical customer segments any longer, because those groups were just not available because of the changed environment. So they really recognized that there was still a big trend of people really wanting to be social, and weddings were happening no matter what. So they thought, well, what can we do to accommodate this and make this also something that was safe and of great value? So really thinking about developing a product around micro weddings, packages for not more than 10 people. And so that was something that really worked for them. And in fact, they reported that, their bookings for micro weddings really surpassed their expectations. Mentioned that staycation trend as well. Again, thinking about the different value proposition, we've seen small hotels and bed and breakfasts reminding people that if you want to take it kind of a break from your home right now, look at four different walls in what you're looking at right now, and certainly people kind of really need that break, or even a kind of a work from home and new situation. We saw an interview with the sales director at Hotel Providence, and he reported that they got a lot of calls, customers or potential customers saying, I've never been to Providence before. So it also opened up an opportunity for people that were first-time visitors to that area. A lot of people taking road trips, a lot of people inquiring, what will it be like when I get there? What is open right now? Are you serving food right now? What is the food experience right now in the midst of and some restrictions in the areas. So just being ready for that information and conveying through social media channels these new experiences and opportunities. And then Cliff House is another example. And I think Estefania is coming in as well. Estefania, how's your audio now?
Take two, can you guys hear me?
Yes, yes, that's much better.
Hopefully it's any better. So the Cliff House at Maine, it's one of Maine's most visited hotels. They have new equipped guest rooms with HIPAA filters and public space cleaning automatically with UV lights. They did a great job creating a particular comfortable surroundings for people to have dinner with their own bubbles. They also have these private igloos, as you can see. And we thought it would be a great idea to also learn about the creative packages. One, it's the Safe Harbor package, which it actually allows you to request a test that will arrive directly to your home, and you will have the results about 72 hours before arrival. So you can have a peace of mind, and it's completely up to you to share the results, but it will definitely give peace of mind. And also they have a strong social media following. And one of the cool things that they have for their media consumption is that a live camera that allows you to view how the weather is at the hotel live, and also a particular package that is called the Stormwatcher package, where you can go and catch some really good views of the storms as well. So we're really glad to show you these examples today. Thank you, Michael.
Thanks, Estefania, for sharing these great examples. And so you can imagine that, you know, not only are these great kind of just awareness of, you know, changed landscape through the pandemic, but also recognizing that consumer behavior and demand are, that's also changing. So recognizing digitization is a big influence. And in our workshop today, we want to think about, you know, how can we not only get through the pandemic that we're in right now, but also become resilient and ensure that we have practices in place to get through other changing forces, which is the move for digitization. And over 92% of companies thought that the business models needed to change anyway because of digitization. So I want to open up another poll question and wonder, what barriers have you encountered as you've worked through to adapt through the pandemic? Whether it's aligning budget, maybe there are some other, you know, personal matters that you had to tend to. Did you have a business continuity plan? Did a lack of continuity plan kind of impact that ability to adapt? Staffing resources, online platforms, being able to kind of work through a business model pivot, or maybe it's really not clear kind of the current circumstances and maybe you've struggled to pivot right now. So I will open up that poll for you and we'll appreciate your feedback. Again, helping us to, you know, prioritize which areas in the toolkit that we provide for accommodations and hospitality businesses. We'll leave this poll open for about 7 more seconds or so, but we're seeing already some early results. Staff and resources, limited access there, personal matters. And, you know, like we mentioned before, you know, it kind of starts with being able to have a support network and kind of personal resources to get through. Because of course, you know, leadership itself, you need to certainly take care of yourself and your family around you before there's ability to move on to other things. Great, wonderful. So we have some good feedback here. Aligning budgets, also lack of continuity plan we're seeing, implementing online platforms, and some people looks like, you know, not really sure how to pivot. Thank you very much for offering, you know, that feedback. This is very helpful. So we will introduce four tools here that we hope that is helpful as you kind of work through even planning now. The first one is a business strategy pivot checklist. We think this is helpful if even just now, but also something you can revisit whenever you feel like you need to have a refresh of your business model. And the first point is taking inventory of your current resources. So if there is a sudden disruption because of an event or a crisis, really look at, okay, what do we have at our disposal right now? What expertise do we have across our current team? Even if there are team members that played a certain role, what other expertise do they have? Can we shift around responsibilities? Through the pandemic, a lot of businesses kind of reposition resources to focus more on content development, social media engagement. Taking a look at the value you deliver to your customers and think about what new customer segments might you be able to put some attention to. How have the needs changed of the customers you've come to rely on? And what risks are there right now? And how do we mitigate some of those risks or put attention on lower risk opportunities? So really just having that kind of self-awareness across the business and the team members. Second, then start to ideate on new market or new customer opportunities. So in the few examples that we shared so far, there you saw some examples of identifying new reasons for people to visit your property or the different ways you would describe the value there. But also revisit your brand narrative. And I think that's a very important step to really, even if you've been in business for many years, kind of remind yourself, why did you start your business? What is the characterization of your brand personality? Really coming back to your brand story. I think that can provide a lot of inspiration for how to engage with people. And even if the short term, that means there's going to be a decrease in visits, how can we keep reminding people of, kind of all of what you believe in and what you stand for and what's all around your brand, so people can continue to remember you and visit you again when the time is right. And again, we talked about value, thinking outside of just the exact services you provide, and then lining up the right staff and resources and also the funding to execute. So this is kind of a short checklist that we think that works in a number of different times. The other exercise we would recommend, especially in terms of your making sure that you have a good digital plan, is that digital presence audit. So what does that mean exactly? It's really putting yourself in your customer's shoes, thinking about what would they expect when they are searching for options to visit Cape Cod, looking at the what you see when you visit your website or your the different online travel agents that you are connected with. What do those search results look like? What do the descriptions look like? What are the comments like on the various review sites? So really kind of assess all of where you are present online and think about if what you see is aligned with your brand image. And if you're already thinking about that in the context of different customer segments or what is interesting to people in a changed environment, I think you'll have a different perspective and give you some guidance on what things would you want to change or what places do you want to be in that virtual world. In addition to a digital presence audit, we would also recommend a customer experience audit. So I think this is very kind of a natural exercise for hospitality industry because it is all about the experience. So really map out the various touch points across your customer's journey. And this is going from discovery when people find you online in those various platforms or on your website to the point of booking, to the point of visiting your property, and then even afterwards, their experience while they're there, and then when they're not on your property, what is the engagement when in between visits? So really just looking at that full picture. And don't be afraid to just look at the details, like the phone number that you have on your website or on your Google My Business listing or on the online travel agency website, the email address or the contact forms, testing them out and doing that regularly, just making sure that it is all working as expected. And do what we call a friction check. Is there any part of the process that feels like, oh gosh, this is a lot of effort, or this is not really the experience that I want to provide to my customers? So do some of those checks, review this with your staff as well, so they are kind of in on this process, so they can also make some suggestions on how to improve and remove some of that friction. And then finally, with those different exercises, come to the table and work on a digital strategy. So here is a simplified checklist. Obviously there could be a lot of detail around a digital strategy, but we think at least these three components, your website. So even if you are relying on the OTAs or other platforms, your website is still a very crucial component. And think about what valuable content are you providing? How are you adding additional value to your customers and your visitors? Do you have a direct booking engine on your website? So you also have that direct channel without having to pay commissions. Is your site mobile optimized? Is your site also optimized with SEO tactics in mind? So think about all of those kind of ways that people could discover you, making sure that your site is being built with that experience and kind of customer conversion in mind. And then that multi-channel marketing strategy. So it's, I think, very good idea to have some exposure on the OTAs, but also thinking about how can you engage with customers directly. So various social media channels, your email marketing. And this also relates to the third point, having the capacity to collect your customer data. Customer data is really key as we move along more towards a digital strategy. So especially in industries where there's a lot of reliance on third parties like the OTAs, you want to make sure that you do have enough data where you can serve your customer with really great and specialized experiences that are catered just for them. So if you feel like you haven't collected not only their email addresses, but also their preferences, when they like to visit, more about them as a whole, what kind of behavior do they do when they're looking across different options? Are they visiting your website, or are they using certain sites or visiting certain tourist sites on Cape Cod? Just all of that information gives you really great insights on how to really serve your customer well. And you'll, as we move along, you'll see a lot of kind of hints on how this checklist is really important. So we'll get to our third poll question now. Which business planning exercises are helpful? So kind of reflecting on kind of where you are right now with your accommodations business. Which of these exercises or audits do you feel, could really be interesting and perhaps you would like to learn more about? I'll open up that poll question now as well for everyone. So that should have now popped up on your screen. So is it, that revisiting that your core capabilities and resources, kind of reminding, what strengths are and where to really put more attention on strengths, revisiting brand narrative and value, digital presence, customer experience, or just very broadly digital marketing and that multi-channel strategy. So we'll leave that open just for a few more seconds. And we're seeing some responses on, that the digital presence audits and customer experience And for sure, those are two just kind of approaches that we think should really be part of an ongoing operations strategy. And now some additional responses as well, core capabilities and also brand narrative. So it sounds like across the board, you know, some of these are quite helpful. So thank you very much for sharing that. We'll go ahead and end the poll there now. But it looks like digital presence, audit, and customer experience really bubbled up to the top. Wonderful. So we put together just a few examples of what tools or platforms kind of really embrace these strategic components. So these examples are not necessarily, or certainly not endorsements, but just sort of reflective of the types of services that are out there. And if you do some searches across something like Cloud Beds, you can even find other alternatives or others in its class. But this is an example of a property management system that it kind of allows you to have your own booking engine. It's sort of a next generation technology that it allows you to not only have your own direct channel, but also manage the other channels you would have with OTAs. Also, I mentioned the trend in the industry that it's sort of becoming very reflective of the e-commerce world, where it's very much an app ecosystem. The opportunity to integrate other apps like loyalty apps or experience apps, or kind of more like that contactless interaction, these kind of hybrid experiences, even when people are on property, everyone is on their mobile phone as well. In this case, they also have the ability to manage some accounting aspects. So, you know, some of these platforms can be considered like kind of a new operating system for hoteliers. Another example is littlehotelier.com. So this one designed for the smaller kind of guest house and small hotel. In this example, they have a built-in web builder. So Cloud Beds integrates with your website if you built it on WordPress or Wix or Squarespace or another platform. Here, if you wanted to have really this all-in-one solution, you could create your website within this platform in addition to some of those property management solutions, including the direct booking and managing payments. Also, the trend of the kind of the exploding hotel SaaS industry, this site here, Hotel Tech Report, is kind of a great site that we ran across and we would recommend, where you kind of have a comparison of different tech tools. So their goal here is to help hoteliers discover new technology, different products to modernize and grow their business. So combining technology solutions, but also reflective of design, storytelling, and that data management. And I think that's so important even for smaller hoteliers, being able to start to embrace the opportunities that come with managing data around your customers. And then multi-channel strategy. So thinking about also even something like your Google My Business listing, always wanting to optimize that. So we included a link here in this QR code, some tips on not only setting up your Google My Business listing, which it looks like that most people that registered for this event already have and utilize, but also thinking about it as almost like your mini website that does need ongoing nurturing. So that link there has some tips on optimizing your local Google My Business listing, which is great for local SEO. And then of course, the other players out there, the OTAs, and according to hospitalitynet.org, their perspective is that, yes, they are valuable here, but it's probably not sustainable to rely on them as a sole strategy, making sure that hoteliers do have a really solid direct channel, because that is really going to be kind of the method of also being able to collect all the data you can to serve your customers better. And then, of course, your social media channels to engage with people and share the different value propositions you have for your properties. We shouldn't forget about customer loyalty. So, you know, often when we think about marketing, we're thinking about how do we acquire new customers? How do we get new people coming in? Of course, that's important, but we should be reminded that acquiring a new customer can cost 5 times more than retaining an existing customer. And I think in an area where there's you know, seasonal business as well, there are opportunities to still engage with people while they might not be visiting Cape Cod. And you know, there are different tips to kind of cultivate loyalty. There's this example here. So Stash Hotel Rewards is just an example of a company that focuses all in on loyalty, specifically for the smaller hotelier. So we're not talking about the loyalty program of Marriott or anything like that, but they recognize that there's a lot of value in having a loyalty program to keep engaged and provide a service for people that, you know, love to visit Cape Cod on an annual basis. So that's something to consider or look at alternatives in that field. So just want to make sure that loyalty is also on mind. That's very important. And then thought we would throw this one in there as well. You know, all the attention on digital marketing, but there is still a place for some traditional marketing also that can actually be seen as sort of a hybrid. And a complement to your digital efforts. So direct mail campaigns, you know, sending out postcards or engaging with your current customer list. You say, as an example, Vistaprint has a function to send out postcards to targeted demographic lists. So it's more granular than just say by a zip code. Obviously you can also upload your own customer list as well. And sometimes if this is in conjunction with an email campaign that you do, that could be kind of an interesting campaign. So you're kind of engaging with people in a multiple media. And you can also put a QR code on any mailing you provide to track the effectiveness of such campaigns. It's just another idea that you might have in your toolkit. So our fourth poll question today is, you know, which of the following digital marketing and e-commerce elements are areas that could use further development at your property? Is it more development on the website? So thinking about, you know, what we mentioned, those important components of SEO, customer experience, the navigation, the call to action buttons, social media, utilizing those channels, even booking through social media, customer engagement and loyalty, strategy with OTAs, property management system, like the platforms we mentioned, or the local SEO. So I will open up that poll for those questions now. So I think that has popped up on your screen. And be really curious to kind of hear, kind of maybe even it's reflective of the conversations you've been having amongst your team, you know, which of the areas that you've been thinking about that need some more development. Great. This is wonderful. So getting a lot of good feedback here, website, social, well, we've had results across all of these options right now, but it looks like we're getting a few more on the company website, social media, and also the strategy with OTAs. So I'll give it just a few more seconds, making sure everyone has an opportunity to respond. Wonderful. Great. So thank you very much. I'll go ahead and end the poll here for that. The company website, social media, and OTAs bubbled up to the top with some responses with the others as well. Great. So we've talked about, you know, different ways to, you know, assess your strategy, get through the planning phase, get some ideas going. But we know as small business owners, we can have all the ideas, but if we don't have time to execute, if we can't get it all kind of delegated and completed, that's going to be really tough. You know, how do we realize all of this? And that can be a really stressful component, especially now. We want to acknowledge that. So if you haven't kind of explored different outsourcing or freelancer platforms, we thought we would just introduce that idea. And as an example, Upwork.com is a site, in fact, that we use for different social media projects that we have here at Refi. But pretty much most of the areas that we've talked about, there is someone that has expertise in that area. And especially if it's a short-term project or even medium-term, you know, there's someone that is, you know, ready to help you out in a virtual capacity, whether it's, you know, working on a particular website, your e-commerce setup, you know, especially if your hotel also sells products as a diversified revenue stream, maybe you're setting up also a Shopify site, you know, managing social media. You know, often as business owners, we don't have a lot of time for that, or other content creation. So just wanted to raise that as also another tool in your toolkit. But also speaking in terms of, you know, feeling like there's a lot on our plates, and, you know, in the greater context of business resiliency, it's important to recognize also ourselves as leadership in your business. And Estefania wants to share a little bit on this topic. I think it's really quite important.
Definitely. And thank you, Michael. And in the spirit of not taking everything on ourselves, can we go to the next slide, please? We want to make sure that we take a moment to acknowledge that life is difficult enough, and being an entrepreneur means that we have a higher rate of burnout than other regular employees. You only don't have the family at home to worry about, but also your family at work. And if we throw in a pandemic now, then you get a really difficult time to bubble up. So we encourage you here to build skills to endure hardship and also to avoid burnout. As Michael mentioned, all the strategies and different inventories that you may want to do in your business, that's something that you want to also apply on yourself and make sure that you are strong and build enough to accomplish all these tasks. First, perhaps take an inventory of your own networks. Are you connecting with positive professionals? Are you connecting with the good contacts that will bring you good ideas and stay in a positive environment? Revisit your goals and also your goal setting process. You want to make sure that we're keeping things realistic, and besides keeping them realistic, breaking them down into steps. And then think about the last slide that Michael presented about the different type of help you can get. What are some of the steps that you're handling yourself that you can easily delegate? And perhaps you can bring someone with a little bit more expertise and to have a broader picture and help you on this easier task. Remain proactive and helpful, and try to maintain a good perspective about take time, perhaps once a day, to step back and look at the bigger picture. And this will be tremendously helpful. Also, and perhaps the most important point for me in this slide is start by taking care of yourself. Let's not undervalue the basics of just keeping an eye on our healthy diet and including exercise, a good amount of sleep. And crucial for all the entrepreneurs is to practice a stress technique to help you manage the stress. And we here at Revi suggest a meditation. And remember to fill your cup before you fill the others. And please keep those in mind. Thank you, Michael.
Yes, very important reminders for sure. And we'll now conclude our workshop with just a few resources that we thought would also be helpful. Kind of going through, again, I think that as many resources as possible is so important, especially right now. And if you haven't visited Hello Alice, helloalice.com yet, this is a great resource for many different industries that are just different resources translatable to pretty much every business type. So take a look at that. There's a lot of, we know that a lot of accommodations businesses also have a food part of their operations. So there's some good food safety resources, but also reopening guidance, digital marketing, and other business planning resources. Also other content and networking opportunities. We see that there's a Facebook group, especially for Cape Cod small business owners, So there is a QR code to link to that if that looks interesting to you. I think just kind of sharing stories with people, getting some ideas and inspiration, or even really just sort of that support that we're all in this together is so important. Like we mentioned, we know that food is also an important component. If you haven't heard of Branch Food, this is an organization based in Boston. They have set up a really great on-demand video site, that page there with different videos from how to leverage data to reduce food waste and supplier costs or cash flow for food businesses, and leveraging user-generated content, which is a big trend right now, and heavily used in a marketing campaign. So you might want to check that out. And then our traditional kind of options for marketing. If you haven't heard of Alignable yet, this is a platform designed specifically for small business owners. There's QR codes linked to that. And kind of connecting with other similar businesses, even if it's outside of Cape Cod, might be interesting to connect with people. But it really is optimized for that community engagement in a hyper-local area. And LinkedIn, of course, they have kind of this newer platform specifically for small businesses, not just LinkedIn doesn't have to be seen as just a platform for the larger corporations. So there's a link there as well. We'll end out here with just a few links. And like I mentioned, this copy of the presentation will be made available. So don't worry if you haven't caught all of these yet. There are great resources on the Cape Cod Commission site, mass.gov, Small Business Strong, if you haven't heard of this initiative, created specifically for the COVID-19 pandemic, offering some free guidance for small business owners across Massachusetts, and a newsletter called CO by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. If you're not on their mailing list yet, I heavily encourage you to do so. A lot of great content coming out of there, and it's particularly from all of the funding programs that are being made available for small businesses. We'll close out with our final poll question. And again, this is helpful for us as we're creating our toolkits. The resources that we just shared will be, you know, obviously some good ideas, but what other ideas we like to see in terms of third-party resources and links that would be helpful for your business across business training, perhaps, employee training, marketing, industry-specific funding, maybe even startup and entrepreneurship or other resources, professional networking and local government. So I'll open up that poll here as our final opportunity for some feedback. But if we didn't capture all of the feedback you would like to provide, I will follow with an email address that you can share with some questions. But just shortly after this poll, we'll have a few moments for some questions here live during our webinar. So it looks like the feedback so far is digital marketing and industry-specific resources. So that certainly will be amongst those included in our toolkits. And now some of the additional responses coming across, most of the others as well. Looks like we have business training, funding, entrepreneurship and professional networking included as well. Awesome. Thank you very much for sharing that. I'll go ahead and close out that poll. And yeah, digital marketing and industry specific bubbling up to the top there. Great. So we would like to invite you to try out the digital presence audit and maybe even some of the other checklists that were presented today. We would love to hear, you know, how that went. Any questions, you are welcome to bring those to our next workshops, which will occur in late April or early May timeframe. But I will thank you very much for joining us and your attention and open up to any questions point we might have today.
So Michael, we have a couple of questions here. The first one says, what is your specific experience marketing for lodging?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so our experience is heavily in marketing, digital marketing across really all different small business industry types. you know, when I go into a new meeting with a business owner, we always characterize ourselves as having the perspective of some good strategy and marketing frameworks, and combining that with the kind of the expertise, but also the passion for your own unique business. Because even across accommodations and hospitality, they're all so different. So that's sort of like our approach, and kind of combining those two strengths and seeing what interesting things come out of that. So I do hope that, you know, some of these checklists and frameworks, in combination from your own perspectives and your knowledge of who your customers are, and what matters to them and what matters to you, your own core values, you know, bringing those together is sort of, you know, what we kind of hope can come out of this.
Thank you, Michael, for that customer centric answer. And our following question says, are any ADA compliant? So I think this this attendee is asking about the booking engines, if are any of them ADA compliant.
Yeah, so the examples provided, I don't know for sure. And that's an interesting question that we would want to check out. And just in general, so this is really good feedback, because we can even you know, can do a bit more research on that and include some of the information that we see on that topic, ADA compliance in terms of the digital platforms and third-party platforms, and the decisions as a business owner that you want to take to make sure that you are in compliance. So thank you for that feedback. I don't know for sure with those specific examples, but we'll take that back with us.
Excellent. Well, that concludes the questions for now.
Great. So we are just about at the hour as well. So we do hope that this was a interesting presentation for you. Like I mentioned, if any other questions do come up in the meantime, businessrecovery@capecodcommission.org is the email address set up where you may relay any additional questions. But we will look forward to seeing you at our next round of workshops for accommodations and hospitality businesses. Thank you very much for your attention, and see you soon.